Okay, so this is something which is on the border of science and procrastination. So I think this is one of my favorite procrastination things I'm doing. And my excuse for that is that I think that this actually enables me to do better science. So you probably all know this this XKCD graphic about a kid at school who's kind of sabotaging the school database because it's too open. Myself, I only got into SQL at a really late stage of my career, so essentially my last years of my PhD. And I was thinking, this is really actually nice to be used. So this is kind of the thing I want to promote, is that there's really good value in embracing your database. we all have data, so I kind of ask you to think about what kind of data catalog you're using. So maybe some of you who uses a file system as a database catalog, maybe raise your hand, right? I think everybody will probably use the file system, which has names, it has storage sizes, it has access times, etc. So it has a list of meta information about your data, and we're using that. So you can use like a file explorer, which is a graphical user interface to your file system. But it's really limited if you think about it. There's lots of things which you cannot do, or if you start to combine different data sets, you run into a lot of problems. So that's kind of the motivation, the idea behind this geoslurp package, which I developed. You can find it on GitHub. And the idea is that it will give me a flexible way to kind of download data sets from all kinds of servers, all kinds of repositories, and also update them. And then I kind of take from that data set meta information, which I think is interesting to be able to query on. So this could be geospatial data, could be time spans of the data sets. And I store this meta information in a database. I don't want to reinvent the wheel. So there's PostgreSQL and PostGIS, and they do absolutely fine, right? So I don't need to reinvent the wheel for this. It also allows you to kind of share by default, so more people can access the database, so people can actually see what kind of data sets your colleagues have, for example. And because this is kind of a standard database, putting this data on this database system also allows other protocols. So you can look into your data with QGIS, for example, if you have to use spatial information there. And you can do all kinds of nice and fancy queries. So once you have more data sets, the amount of data sets which are in your database, the amount of connections you can make between those data sets explodes, the amount of opportunities explodes. So this geoslurp philosophy is kind of targeting not read-only users at the first place, but scientists who want certain flexibility in querying data sets, setting up, putting this into a data catalog. Of course, it does not make sense to put all your data into a database. So if you have like model data, terabytes of data, you does not necessarily need to put everything in a database, only that part which you actually want to apply a query on. So instead, you can use file paths to where you find your data sets. So one part of geoslurp is that it will make downloading stuff easier. So there's some routines and some functionality in there which allows you to download certain data sets. There's kind of a whole list of standard data sets. I kind of add them as I need, right? If I see a certain need for data, I kind of add a certain data set. Essentially, every data set comes with a scheme, like a top directory, as you can say it, where you can put it, and a dataset name, and has two functionalities which you need to implement, pool and register. So this is, in fact, a command line program. However, you can also do this dynamically in Python. I think Python is amazing in the sense that it's one of the few languages which allow you to make a dynamic class, a class at runtime. And that's also the philosophy which is used here. So, for example, we have like this base class dataset, which is provided by this toolbox. You derive from that, and you need to implement a pool function. Where do you get your data, and where do you store it? And a register function. What kind of data do you want to extract, and what do you want to put into your database? And this is a very primitive version, but there's also versions which already do common things like importing OGR. data sets, for example. another thing is that I want to make it more easier if you're doing a Jupyter notebook or you're doing Python programming, is you can store and retrieve X-Array data sets. So I also wrote a little X-Array accessor, it's called. So you can import those from this tool. Essentially, this is how you make a connection with the database. And then at some stage, these are code fragments, but this is actually an X-Array data set, and you can save these into your database and also retrieve them at some stage. So the idea behind is that allows you to easier put stuff in there and retrieve it. Some examples of what you can do, because I think that's the candy, right? Which is the potential of this. I don't know if you can see it, but this looks a bit strange. If you look at it closely, you see all those triangles. This is in fact data or a grid from an unstructured ocean model, which has triangles certain depths, and you can actually use the database to kind of store those triangles. At the same time, you also add into your database radar altimetry tracks and Argo floats. So the green dots here are locations for Argo floats. At a certain time, they come and they go because they're freely frozen. If you have all this in a data set, it allows you to make interesting queries. For example, where do my ground tracks, my radar altimetry tracks, intersect with the model nodes? So these can be interesting tools, for example, in data assimilation scheme. If you know your grid is constant over time, it can provide you some surface to do better data assimilation, for example. Another example, also with radar altimetry. This example is in the Nile Basin. The question is, okay, where do I find those points where my radar altimetry is crossing a certain river? And maybe I want to add other constraints. For example, I only want those which are in the vicinity of a discharge station. Or I only want those crossings which cross a river with a certain width. And the nice thing about putting this all together in a database is that you can start making interesting queries. So these are, in fact, potential candidates for so-called virtual gauge stations in the Nile River system. This gets a bit more technical, but this geoslurp system is essentially a client part and a database part. It has no graphical interface. I'm somebody who thinks of graphical interfaces as an afterthought, right? I don't usually have time to develop something like that. But it does allow you to be run at remote locations. And for example, this system, this geoslurp database coupled with this geoslurp client, has already been run at the Jülich IHPC computing center, because we had those big data sets of those ocean models stored there, and it allowed us to do those queries on Argo data and compare them with the model data on site. And there's actually a version running on the CRIP infrastructure as well. So this is one configuration, but I think I like the idea that this allows you to, it's kind of a microservice which you can put in your computing strategy to be able to leverage on those Postgres things. To kind of conclude, in a way you can think of geoslurp as a, when we start off with a file system on steroids, right? You add an extra layer which allows you to do much more queries than what you get if you just consider a file system. And if you're interested, please do check out the GitHub repository or contact me. I think in the future, I see this as an interesting way to deploy at several sites. It's a relatively lightweight service, depending on what you do with it, but it's not very computation intensive. And I also think it might be nice if you have like an established processing chain that you can put this somewhere, you download all the data sets you need, and you wrap the whole thing with a public interface, so users who are not interested in developing this processing chain can actually still access the data which results from this. So that's it.
Thank you very much, Roelof, for your presentation. So are there any questions from the audience? Yes, sir.
Yeah,
Yes, Peter?
Yes, thanks for the nice talk. I'm wondering, so you mentioned there is also an instance running on CRIP, but of course the usefulness comes with the data that's available there to other people. So what are the typical data sets that you offer or that you...
So for me, so as I said, the data sets which I've kind of standardized into this routine or stuff which I use myself, these could be river discharge data sets from GRDC, the reference tracks from altimetry. In the past I've used those unstructured models. There are also common GIS shapes, like from the Natural Earth data set, right? You can also pull them in if you need to compare those. And there's the whole list, actually.
But if I say, for example, that there are several people here that would like to make use of satellite images, recent, maybe incoming data, and so on, do they then, would it be possible to easily fetch all that data, which can be a lot quite, and then to make it accessible for all those users?
Yes. So in that case, I would kind of recommend to store the tiles, right? Not the actual data, but the tiles and the links where to get the data in this database. And that allows you to kind of maybe apply a query. Okay, I'm interested in this area. How can I retrieve then the actual data, right? Yeah. So in that case, if it's a global data set or a really large data set, I would kind of be inclined to store the tile information and the time coverages in the database, but not as such the rasters themselves. No.
Okay, thank you.
Stack catalog can help, actually, maybe with that. And maybe you can provide also a stack endpoint so that people can access it easily. This stack spatiotemporal asset catalog, so that's a kind of new standard, and there are some clients which allows you to connect that kind of services, and if a connection can be created, then people can also access through that, and then they query in a standard way the data that's available.
And I think the interesting part is, in the end, like the data, all the stuff is stored in a standard, industry standard database, so there's different ways to connect to that. Geoslurp is one way, right? But there's other ways,
Thank you very much, Roelof, for the presentation.